Welcome to Oscoda County. Located along the Oswego River Valley in the northern part of Michigan's Lower Peninsula. Oscoda County is divided into six townships. There are no incorporated towns or villages. Even the county seat of Mayo is not its own entity, but rather it is under the jurisdiction of two different townships. In addition to Mayo, there are the unincorporated villages of Fairview, Cummins, Luzerne, and McKinley. The county draws thousands of tourists each year. They come for the natural beauty of the rivers and the forests. They come for the festivals and the unique wildlife. They come for the thousands of acres of public land for camping, hunting, skiing, or riding. But between the forests and streams, between the farms and sawmills, signs remain of days gone by. The land that is Oscoda County became part of the Union with the Treaty of Saginaw in 1819. The first to come to this land were lumbermen, who came to make a profit from the abundant pines found in the southern part of the county. Camps sprung up as the men harvested the timber. The logs were transported by wagon, sled, or narrow gauge rail to the river where they were floated to the mills downstream. And harvest the timber they did. The land south of the river was turned into a sea of stumps, leaving a barren wasteland behind. The Federal Public Domain Commission actively encouraged people to settle this newly cleared land. This brought to the area settlers interested in making a home out of the wilderness. Some of the earliest settlers came into the area in the post-Civil War era. Coolidge Cummins, Ben Keeley, Rock Vaughn, and John Colgrove, to name a few. These names are still familiar in the area, as they can be found on roads, township names, and even some of the families still residing in the county. More settlers gradually moved into the area through the mid to late 19th century, so that at the incorporation of the county in 1881, there were already settlements at Union Corners and Mack City in the south, and Cummins and Potts headquarters in the north. Oscoda County had been Cummins Township in Alcona County before being set apart. The original county was divided into only three townships, Mount Pindus, Atherton, and Cummins. Township lines changed over the first few decades, with as many as nine townships existing, until settling on the six that are currently designated. The townships remain the main unit of local government and the county. Potts headquarters, now called McKinley, was easily the largest settlement of the later 1800s. It was established by the Albert Potts Salt and Lumber Company, and it was designed to harvest the area timber, and it grew to a population of over 2,000. This settlement supported hotels, a general store, drugstore, five saloons, schools, and a church. In 1890, the Potts Company went bankrupt. They were acquired by the Henry M. Loud and Sons Company. According to local lore, the settlement's name was changed from Potts headquarters to McKinley, in honor of President McKinley. However, the name was changed in 1892, shortly after the company was acquired by the Louds, as President McKinley was not elected until 1896, and subsequently assassinated in 1901, the exact origin of the name is not certain. The Loud Company extended the railroad from Lake Huron to Cummins, leading to McKinley's rapid decline. The presence of the railroad made Cummins the dominant center of economic activity. In addition to the train depot, the town featured a water tower, roundhouse, jail, and stockyard. Lumber, livestock, and supplies were transported in and out of Cummins, and from there to other parts of the county. In the 1920s, the railroad decreased in profitability until it was shut down in 1928. With the loss of the railroad, the importance of Cummins as a shipping center came to an end. The act that incorporated Oscoda County established Union Corners as a temporary county seat. Union Corners was located in the far southwestern portion of the county. This small community of 200, also called Indian Lake, had a hotel, stores, newspaper, and a post office. Like nearby Mack City, the farmland surrounding the village was too sandy for long-term farming. In this time, lumbering had shifted to the hardwoods north of the river, opening land with soil more suitable for farming. So settlers in this area pulled up stakes after a few years and moved to the more fertile lands north. Today, nothing remains of Union Corners other than a small cemetery and an old stump fence. An election was held to determine the permanent county seat. And so it was decided by a margin of 41 votes that the area south of the Saba River called Mayo would be established as the county seat. At the time, there was little in the area other than a few houses, one of which was the home of Maria de Armand, who was known affectionately by her family as Mayo. Over time, her nieces telling people that they were on their way to visit Aunt Mayo made her name synonymous with the area. Selection of Mayo as the county seat was an unlikely choice, as there were no stores and not even a bridge to cross the river at that location. A road was soon constructed from the new county seat to the train line in West Branch, and plans began for a bridge across the Asabo. The next year, in 1882, saw the opening of the first Mayo post office and the construction of the first county courthouse by a team led by John Randall, which he then rented to the county at the rate of $100 per year. The growing county seat added many businesses and even had a public water system from 1890 to 1910, drawing water from the Wolf Creek and taking it as far as M-72. John Randall was a very influential man in the early days of Mayo. In addition to building the first courthouse, he published the first newspaper, called the Northern Mail, located in Union Corners. And later he published the Mail Telegram in Mayo. He was a surveyor and laid out the new town. He was postmaster, a musician, a trained druggist, he pulled teeth and delivered babies. He also donated to the county the land on which the current courthouse was built. This courthouse was built in 1888 for a cost of $3,754, which included a woodshed and two outhouses. Although court is no longer held in this historic building, it is still used for many county offices. John Randall's letterhead proudly described the town he founded as the ideal place for livestock and live people. As the county seat was being established in Mayo, Civil War veteran Major Myron Hageman established a settlement on the Big Creek. As the Hageman family came from Luzerne County, Pennsylvania, they named the new settlement Luzerne, Michigan. Major Hageman was a blacksmith described as a kind, jolly, good-natured person, well-liked by everyone in the community. A fellow settler, Albert Royce, built a dam on the east branch of Big Creek and used it to power a grist mill, shingle mill, and lumber mill, all housed in one building. By 1911, more efficient means existed to grind grain and saw lumber, and the mills were dismantled. Later, an electric generator was installed at this dam to provide electricity to Luzerne until 1933, when the dam was washed out by heavy rains. One of the most enduring establishments in Luzerne is Ma Dieter's. Dieter's Hotel first opened in 1920, further north of M-72, and moved to its current location in 1941. Anna Ma Dieter was also instrumental in the founding of the Luzerne Northwoods Club and served as its first president. The Northwoods Club became the hub of social activity in the Luzerne area for decades. It hosted dances, potlucks, and children's programs. Around the turn of the century, the Home Seeker's Guide, distributed by the Loud Company, offered land for sale from the northern hardwoods that had been lumbered by the company. These guides were distributed along the train routes from Nebraska to Pennsylvania. The opportunity for available farmland resonated in the Amish and Mennonite communities. In 1901, the first Amish families, led by Jeremiah Troyer and Sam Weaver, settled into the Fairview area. Many more followed, so that over the next few years, some 75 Amish families would be living in the area. Several Mennonite families, led by Noah Yoder, Levi Kaufman, and Kilgram Smith, also moved into the Fairview area at this time. They established a church in 1904 with Eli Bontrager as their first pastor. Although there was a marked decline in the Amish community in the mid-20th century, today it is thriving with many families living in the area between Kittle and Fairview. At the time of settlement, lumbering had opened the line of sight from hilltop to horizon. Alexander Scott, farmer and postmaster, is credited with coining the name Fairview from the Spanish Buena Vista. The first Fairview business was a general store opened by Els Troyer in 1904. As Cummins railroads failed, many of the businesses in Cummins moved to Fairview. The exact location of Fairview has not always been where it is currently, but rather it has moved as the location of the post office has moved. In addition to the Amish and Mennonites, early settlers practiced many different faiths. Methodist ministers may have preached occasionally in the area as early as the mid-19th century. In 1885, the Mayo Methodist Church was founded by Reverend John Wesley Hollowell, who preached on Sundays and worked the rest of the week on the farm of Coolidge Cummins. This is where the school and church building was located. By 1905, a Catholic station had been established, along with churches from the Baptist, United Church of Christ, and Seventh-day Adventist faiths. The decades that followed would see the addition of the Church of God, Lutheran, and Episcopal congregations, as well as the change of the Catholic station to St. Mary's Catholic Church and the construction of the Our Lady of the Woods Shrine in the 1950s. Today, Oscoda County is the home of many churches with a wide range of faiths. Many small villages have come and gone over the years. Many of these came from lumbering or settlers attempting to farm sandy soil. William DeArmond once described farming in the sandy soil near Max City as a very simple matter because a man could plow and sow and never be bothered with the problem of reaping. As the timber disappeared and the soil was depleted, the residents moved on and the towns disappeared. These towns can be traced to the record of the post offices in the county. The first was the Harmon Post Office, located where the old state road crossed the Isauble River in what is now Big Creek Township. Alex Patello, whose descendants are still residing in the county, was its first postmaster. Post offices were established in the settlements of Biggs, Neyland, Odessa, Indian Lake, Wood, Max City, Royce, and Spore, none of which are still in existence today. A nest of the rare Kirtland's warbler was first discovered in the western part of the county in 1903 by Norman Wood of the University of Michigan and Mr. Parmalee, a local trail and fishing guide. This find generated significant interest as no other nest of the species had been found within a 100-mile radius. In the 1950s, the Michigan Department of Natural Resources and the U.S. Forest Service began setting aside land and managing it specifically for the Kirtland's warblers. Kirtland's build their nest on the ground below 5 to 10-year-old jack pines. Management efforts include harvesting and planting jack pines so that trees of the correct age are always available, and controlling walkers through the nesting area so that nests are not crushed underfoot. One ill-fated effort was a 210-acre controlled burn on May 5, 1980. High winds and low humidity made the fire spread quickly and it was soon out of control. Tragically, one of the fire technicians operating a tractor was caught in the blaze and lost his life. The fire spread at a remarkable 2 miles an hour and had flames as high as 50 feet. By the time the fire was contained, over 25,000 acres had burned. Losses included 44 homes and the Mack Lake Fire Department building with the fire engine still inside. The year since Corporation has seen many changes to the county. In the early days of Mayo, the river could only be crossed at Camp 10 Bridge or Cummins Flats. The first bridge to cross the Isauble at Mayo was a wooden bridge built in 1886. In 1928, a new steel bridge was constructed and served the county for many years until that bridge was removed and the present bridge was constructed. When the 1928 bridge was replaced, it was moved to Camp 10 and served as the crossing in that location for many years until being replaced in 1974. Today, the Camp 10 fishing piers mark the location of the steel bridge crossing. Construction of the Mayo Dam began in 1913 by the Eastern Michigan Power Company. The construction and necessary brush clearing took 3 years, with the electric generators coming online in 1916. Although it has undergone many renovations over the years, the structure of the dam is essentially the same. The dam is currently operated by Consumers Energy. In addition to generating 5 megawatts of power, the dam creates the Mayo Pond, the single largest body of water in the county. The Mayo Dam is the furthest dam upstream of the Isauble River and the only dam between Grayling and Mayo. The Civilian Conservation Corps, or CCC, had a large presence in Oscoda County from the Great Depression up to the start of World War II. The CCC was a federal program during the Great Depression designed to put young men to work. One camp in Oscoda County was the Luzerne Camp, which supported 200 to 250 men engaging in work projects of a recreation or conservation nature. The remnants of the Luzerne Camp are still seen off Mapes Road. Early schooling in Oscoda County was dominated by one-room schoolhouses. At one point, there were up to 80 of these dotted throughout the county. As early as 1901, at the annual Fairview Town Meeting, the town decided to provide free textbooks to the students. Currently, there are two dominant public school districts in the county, Miowasauga Schools and Fairview Area Schools. The original Miles School building burned down in 1919 and was replaced by the brick building that is currently used as the courthouse annex. Still today, it is not uncommon for older residents to refer to the courthouse annex building as the school. Additionally, there are Amish schools and a number of people who homeschool their children. One of the oldest buildings in Maya was on the corner of 9th and M33 and was originally constructed for the Union Bank in 1908. In addition to being a bank, that building has also served as several different restaurants and is currently the office for the Oscoda County Chamber of Commerce. For much of the 20th century, greeting visitors in the Mayo downtown were the businesses of Whitney's Drugstore and the Log Cabin Saloon. Whitney's Drugs was established by Roy Whitney in the 1930s near what is now the Mayo Saloon. In 1945, his son Gordon built a larger drugstore across the street. The new drugstore featured a soda fountain and many other conveniences. It continued operations until the 1980s when it was bought out by the Rite Aid Corporation. Its neighbor, the Log Cabin Bar, was a well-known watering hole originally opened by Tom Brooks as early as 1920. Although it changed hands throughout its existence, it was a popular destination for years before it burned down in 1975. The history of Oscoda County is as varied as its residents, so ask someone about the Forestry Expo, Kenny's Variety Store, McCormick's Dry Goods, Gamble's Hardware, or Long's Dairy Barn. But you better be ready to sit for a while and take it all in.